And one thing that is the most important thing for us as Christians, right, is the gospel. Amen? And so this is something that I think is good to just talk about consistently, because that's our message. Our message is gospel. Our lives should be gospel. How we act, how we talk, everything we do is gospel. So we're kind of going back to the basics here, right? And so those of you who are married, or if you've ever been to a wedding or anything like that, I want you to think about your wedding day, or if you've been to a wedding like that wedding that you saw. And it's a joyous occasion, right? It's grand. Maybe some of you are like, well, my wedding day was a little frustrating, you know? Oh, some giggles in here, huh? I wish I could have been there to see that one happen, you know? I've seen people act pretty crazy at weddings, I'm not going to lie. That's neither here nor there. But it's a grand occasion. It's a beautiful moment, right? It's a beautiful day. Can we agree on that? And the point that I'm saying this is, the wedding, although spectacular, although grand, although beautiful occasion, is but a day, right? And how many of you guys know that now begins kind of like the real work, right? Now begins, okay, yeah, a beautiful day, it was fantastic, maybe even had a honeymoon, and then you show up and it's Monday, it's like, oh, all right, like, I'm not in Hawaii or I'm not in Cancun anymore, like, and they're still there. Interesting, right? And I'm not negating the importance of the marriage, or I'm not negating the importance of the wedding day, excuse me, but we all know that a marriage, when it really begins and is after that day, because now you're going to be loyal, you're going to be steadfast, you're going to be caring, you're going to be quick to forgive, right? We're all living those perfect marriages where we do that, right? But the commitment begins in that moment, right? It's a day, but now begins the lifetime of commitment, the lifetime of we are now one, and we are now growing together closer and closer, one flesh, right? Make sense? And I would say that the gospel actually operates a lot like this, because I think for those who have received Christ, we know that the moment that we receive Christ and that he just enveloped us in his presence and we committed our lives to him, I'm sure there's been many tears in that day. There's been many healed hearts, like almost instantly. There's been just changes of perspective in that moment. It's a grand, beautiful thing, and it's a beautiful moment, right? But as a Christian, the gospel, just like a marriage, is not only a day. It's not only a moment. But rather, it becomes now something that it becomes a movement that we work towards every single day. That's our starting base. That's where we start from. And it's not something, again, that is fleeting. It is not something that happened 2,000 years ago. And we're like, oh, thank you. Cool, I'm saved. Now I'm just going to kind of do whatever I want. In the same way, a marriage, you don't get married and you're like, well, now that I'm married, I'm just going to go do whatever I want. Like, I'll see you later, maybe. See you when I get home. It's like, that's not how it works. And gospel preaching and gospel living is the same exact thing. It's not, oh, thank you, Lord, for your salvation. Thank you for your gift. Thank you for Christ Jesus. But now I'm going to go do whatever I want. Now I'm not going to live that out. And so this couple weeks, we're going to go back to the basics and talk about what the gospel is, because I have this philosophy in my head, and I really like it. Just always pops up. It always pops up in my prayer and everything. But we won't talk about things, or we won't share things, or we won't live out a life that's gospel-centered or preach it, or we won't talk about anything in life if we are not confident in what we're sharing, right? Right? So I would be willing to say there's probably a lot of us who are Christians, yes, but maybe we're not confident in what the gospel entails. And so I want us to get back to the basics and get back to what it is. And here's a little study that I found from Barna, which is very reputable organization that does stats on many different things. But they asked Christians, born-again believers, if they felt a responsibility to preach and share the gospel, okay? And 73% of born-again Christians said yes. It should be 100. But here's the thing. When that comes down to practice, right, it's easier said than done. When it comes to practice, 73% said yes, we think that's an obligation. However, 52% said they actually did. And doing it was only once in the past year or year and a half. And so I would absolutely love if that study only related to everybody else outside of here. But I'd be willing to wager that it doesn't. I'd be willing to say, you know what, because I know my life, that's the thing. It's like, man, okay, I need to step up. And how many of you guys know, if you show up to work, if you're leading a team, if only 52% of people showed up for a work day, would that be rough? In anything we do, if only half the people showed up, it's like, oh, man, that's a long day. And so we're living in an era and a time where only half of Christians actually put that gospel message and preaching into practice. And so, like I said, I don't think it's like willful ignorance. I don't think it's I'm going to work hard not to. I just truly believe maybe, you know what, as a church leader, as New Beginnings, maybe we need to get back to the basics and really lay this thing out so that way our believers, our congregation, our family can be confident in sharing, can be confident in what they're saying, can be confident when talking about sin, right? Because how many of us are like, well, Jesus loves you, and it's like, well, what's sin? It's like, it's just that bad stuff, you know? Like, don't worry about that. Like, we're not going to talk about that. Right? And so I want us to know what the gospel is, because the gospel is a life to be lived. It's not just a moment. It's a life to be lived. And I understand the gospel this way, and I believe this 100%, because the gospel just means euangelion in the Greek. It just means good news. The gospel is good news. But here's the thing, and here's why I think we go wrong sometimes, is good news cannot be understood apart from what bad news is. We can't truly, fully understand what good news is unless we know what the bad news is. And so I want to start today by reading, it's a systematic kind of breakdown of the gospel. So we're going to be in Romans, we're going to be in Hebrews, we're going to be in Ephesians, because what we're doing is like we're taking a scope of what Scripture says about the gospel, okay? And so I want to first read in Romans, we're going to be in Romans 3, then after that in Romans 6. So if you have your Bibles, if you have your Bible app, I'll turn to Romans 3, verse 23. And then after that, we're going to be in Romans 6, 23. Because here's the bad news. Here's what the Bible says. Romans 3, 23, it says, "For all have sinned, and all fall short of the glory of God." All means all. That doesn't mean some. That doesn't mean half. That doesn't mean, just those people I don't like. All means all. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And then in Romans 6, here's the thing. Because all have sinned, and we need to see this thread and we need to see this line. Because all have sinned, Romans 6, 23. Here's what it says. "For the wages of sin is death." So if all have sinned, then that means our wages, what sinners deserve, is death. And then as we know, the verse finishes out, "But the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus, our Lord." I even love kind of like the literary features of that. Like it doesn't start, "Hey, the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ," because the wages of sin is death. It says, no, the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life. Even how that's written, it's like, hey, here's the bad news, but here's the good news right after. And here's why this is an issue. Because sin has to be talked about if we're Christians. And today, we're going to really get into it. So if you're a Christian, man, I want you guys to leave today feeling confident, feeling ready to share, feeling ready to break down what sin is, feeling ready to break down what the gospel is. And so sin, in Scripture, it means to miss the mark or to fail in duty. Like you're supposed to do, and you miss the mark, you fail. So if anybody, right, it says, "For all have sinned, fall short of the glory of God." If you've ever cheated, if you ever lied, if you've ever lusted after somebody in your heart, if you've said wicked things within your heart to somebody, if you've done somebody wrong, if you've done anything, if you've basically been a human, you have sinned. You have fallen short. I have fallen short. And this is a part, right, that's like, well, I don't want to hear about that. But that's what Scripture says. We must understand this to be able to fully grasp and fully accept what the good news is. And so here's the issue here, right? Because here's what we got to fight against in our current context, in our current setting, in our current world, is this. We believe as Christians all have sinned, But to those outside of the Christian faith, they would say, well, I've messed up, but I'm being a good person now. I just need to live a good life now. I know I've messed up, but I'm just being a good person. And if I be a good person, then eventually I'll get to somewhere that I need to be, a better place, right? How many of you guys heard that? Because that's the thing. It's like, well, I'll just live a good life. But then the problem with that is, what does that mean? What is good? What does good mean to you? Like, let me break it down for you this way. There, you guys know Nepal? Nepal, like the area, country. I don't know if it's a country, actually. I forget. I think it's a country. But it's a Hindu nation. Yeah, it's a country. And it has a caste system. And what a caste system is essentially there's different ladders, or just there's different rungs of like the social environment. So if you're born into a low caste, like you're poor, you're staying there. There's no moving up to middle class. There's no moving up to above middle class. There's none of that. So wherever you're born, that's where you stay in social settings, in economics. And so here's where this idea of, well, just be a good person. Here's why that doesn't work out. Because over there, they would think of what the definition of good completely different from what I would think, from what you would think, and from what us probably as a nation would think. And because they believe in karma, they believe this is what's good. This, like, just do good things, right? And good things will come. Because they believe in that, they also believe that, hey, because maybe you're poor or something's going wrong or something bad is happening to you, that's just because you've been doing bad. You haven't been doing good. So that's karma coming back to bite you in the butt. And so how this plays out even more so is they drive a lot of those little scooters, right? You guys know what I'm talking about? Meh, meh, you know? It's like if you saw me rolling in on one of those, you'd be like, hey, my guy, you got to get in a car. Like, don't be driving that around. It's embarrassing, right? But they drive a lot of those around. And there's a lot of trucks, that big trucks that go by at the same time. And what happens is many times they hit the people who are driving the scooters. And here's what they'll do. If that person is in a low caste, the poor, they'll stop and they'll see what part of the, like, the economic ladder they are. And if they're in a low caste, they'll finish the job. They'll back right over them. Because guess what? Guess what is good to them? If they're in a low caste, they deserve that. They probably got hit because they just karma coming back to them. And if the person does that, finishes the job, they just have to pay a small fine. But if it's somebody in a high caste system, they're going to stop and make sure that they get them to health, get them to safety. And this is their, like, how they run. So to them, that is what's good and what is just. Do you guys believe that that is good and just? So this idea here, and I'm saying this because I want you guys to think of this idea of, like, well, just be a good person. Being a good person to them is that. Having laws that are good is that. And so if you think from nation to nation, if you just look at culture to culture, what we say is good is nowhere near what somebody else would say is good. And so you think of that as on a large scale, from individual to individual. I think this is good. Somebody else may say, no, I don't think that's good. Or somebody may do something that I think is bad, but they don't think it's bad. So then where does this, like, kind of ball of yarn kind of end? Of just, oh, no, be a good person. Well, what does that mean? And the thing is, what somebody defines as good, somebody else may not agree. So then who's right? And then say even, like, somebody is just like, well, this is what's good. This is what I define as good. Can you then justify me? Can then you say, like, oh, because you know what good is, like, I guess you figured it out. Can you then, like, answer on my behalf and just, like, be good for me? Because I haven't done all what you say is good. I know it's getting, like, a little philosophical, but it's like we have to understand that this idea of, hey, just be a good person makes absolutely no sense. Because nobody knows what good is. Nobody can define it. Nobody can fully understand it apart from God. And so with that said, we can easily point back to the truth that, hey, all fall short, all sin. That makes a ton more sense than this idea that an individual can correctly define what good is for everybody else. That's not going to fly, right? So the truth is we all fall short. So therefore, the wages of sin is death. We are all worthy of death. We are all worthy of justice. How many of you are like, man, I didn't want to hear this today? But that's the bad news. Nobody has the right nor authority to declare themselves as good or to declare others as good, what the Bible would call holy and righteous. That's the bad news. But beautifully for us, there's much better good news. There's much better good news that we get to receive and understand. But the thing is, it's like I've heard of an illustration before. It's like if somebody just all of a sudden you're walking along and you all of a sudden get tackled. And they're like above you, and they're like, and the person above you is just like, I just saved you. It's like, from what? I don't understand. And so the thing is, when we don't describe sin and we don't describe what the bad news is, what the person who tackled them is like from the bus that was just driving by. And so we have to understand, it's like sin must be explained, sin must be described, because that's the bad news. Because people walk in that naturally. So if we don't know what bad news is, we're going to think that this is normal. This is not normal. We have to come out of that. And so here's the beautiful thing, because what's God's response to this? This is what is important. This is such a beautiful thing. So next time, like when you preach the gospel or when you have somebody say they're ready to dialogue with you, sin is something that must be explained. So we know that if all sin, then all deserve their due reward. Because I don't know about you guys, but when somebody does me wrong, I want a little bit of justice, right? Yes. So, hey, somebody eats your leftovers in the fridge, come on. You know, you're like, where's the justice at, bro? You owe me some wings or whatever, right? Yes. In the tiniest things, we want justice. So that's the thing. All have sinned, so all deserve justice. Man has turned from God, but God is merciful. God is kind. God is loving. God is caring. And he is just. He is just. So this is kind of like, this is the situation. This is kind of like the tension within the gospel. Because if God is just, but he's also merciful, what does he do with us? With sinners? What does he do? Because I don't know about you, but if he were just to say, okay, I'll give mercy, I'll look away. I'll just pretend like that didn't happen. Is that just? It's just like turning your back and like, oh, I'll throw it out of my mind. Is that justice? And if he came down and just no chances, no nothing, just kicked us out, is that mercy? No. So that's the tension, because what is there to be done? What is there to be done in this situation? If all sin, all fall short, all are worthy of death, but God is merciful and just, what does he do now? And in Hebrews chapter 2, starting on verse 14, we're going to read through 18. It says this: since therefore the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise partook of the same thing, he being Jesus, that through death, here's the point, through death, he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver all those who through fear of death were subject to lifelong slavery. We know that the curse of sin is what? What is the end game for sin? Death. So therefore, Christ partook in flesh, so that way he could answer and defeat what? Because if we all deserve death and a holy, righteous one answered on our behalf, would it be okay if he stopped right before death and like, all right, I'm out? No, he had to partake in everything that we do so that way he could answer on our behalf. That is justice. That is justice. And it says that he defeated and now has the power over death. So the gospel we see gives us victory, first of all, right? The good news gives us victory over death. Humbling himself to the point of death and then defeating it, his power over death. And through faith in Christ, we now have power and victory over death. And so now here's the thing. We don't live in anxiety towards it. We don't live in fear. I don't know about you guys, but I've had conversations with friends where death is just like terrifying, right? I'm sure you guys have some friends and people like that too. It's like, I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know what I'm going to do. Just there's sometimes I stay up late at night just thinking about it. And that's what the gospel does. Gets rid of that anxiety. Gets rid of that fear. Gets rid of that power of death. And here's the thing. In verse 18 it says, "For because he himself has suffered when tempted, he is able to help those who are being tempted." This is kind of like, let me take a little sidetrack here. I think there's some of us in here that need to understand that there is nothing that you're experiencing, nothing that you're going through, no like stress that you're feeling in your heart, anxiety, kind of like anguish. There is nothing that you are going through that Christ himself has not experienced. So whatever it is, stress, financially stress with, like, Jesus' ministry is probably like, well, I don't know how we're going to make it today, but we're just going to go, we're going to keep going. Whatever stress, whatever fear, whatever doubts, whatever anxieties you may have, our Lord Jesus Christ has experienced them as well. And he has been tempted. And it says in the same way that he is able to help those who are being tempted. I don't know about you, but any God that's ever been trying to explain as true, all the gods of the Greeks, all the gods of the ancient Near East, of the Babylonians, of the Akkadians, of the Sumerians, all these gods are more like caring about themselves than any of their creation. One of the Babylonian gods, or Egyptian gods, excuse me. This is just a little side note, I'm sorry. But essentially, their version of this god, he created humanity, and he decided to wipe them all out because they stank. They care, like, these gods that are described are just like super out of touch, super non-personal, because that's all those false gods. But our God is personal. Our God is caring. Our God is, he experiences and experienced tempting so that way he could help us and push us through. That's the God that we serve. That's the God who saved us through Christ Jesus. Through Christ Jesus. And in verse 16, it says this in Hebrews 2, verse 16. It says, "For surely..." Oh, excuse me. I'm sorry. I like hopped verses there. I apologize for that one. We're going to be in verse 16 now. I apologize for that one. It says, "For surely it is not angels that he helps, but he helps the offspring of Abraham." The offspring of Abraham is what? Humans, us. And he says, "Therefore, he had to be made like his brothers in every respect, that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in the service of God to make propitiation for the sins of the people." Does anybody know what propitiation means? Yeah, it's the idea, essentially, of God, like, Jesus took on, and these are words that we don't like to hear in church, but Jesus took on the wrath that was deserved because of sin. So Jesus became the replacement. Jesus substituted himself for us. He atoned on our behalf, because I don't know about you guys, but I couldn't, like, atone on my own behalf. I would not be able to handle justice from God. Amen? But it says that he was made to propitiation for the sins of the people. He took on our sins. He carried them. He took them from us, and instead, like Paul says, he put on his righteousness onto us. He put on his righteousness onto us. And I love that it says he made himself like his brothers in every respect, humans, so that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in the service of God. The high priest in the Old Testament on the Day of Atonement would walk into the temple and offer up a sacrifice once a year on behalf of all the people. He'd have to, like, know what everybody's sins are, place them and kill the animal and throw the blood on the altar on behalf of all the sins of all the people. We're just talking about it in the pregame meeting. This is how holy God is, that for a time, they would wrap a rope around these high priests, because if they did something wrong or confessed something wrong, God would strike them dead. So they tied a rope to them. Why? It's like, oh, all right, let's pull them out. Let's pull them on out. And so this high priest would sacrifice the animal on behalf of the sins of the people. So in saying that Christ Jesus is the high priest, he sacrificed himself on behalf of whom? Because what? The wages of sin is what? And who sins? Everybody. Everybody. So he is our faithful high priest who took on my sins, your sins, the sins of humanity. And now through belief in him, we have an eternal life waiting for us. And so here's the thing, though. Because we're not universalists, meaning we don't think, well, Jesus did that, so now everybody on earth just has a free ticket to heaven because Jesus atoned for the sins of humanity, right? We're not universalists in the sense of like, oh, yeah, well, that means because he did that, that I don't have to respond. I don't have to do anything. I don't have to acknowledge, like, Christ just died for all sins, so I'm good now. No, that's not what Scripture says. And as a matter of fact, Jesus' death and taking on our sins, it warrants a response. And here's like a way. Jesus died for all? Yes. But that, like, sacrifice is applied to those who put their faith in Christ Jesus. And so Jesus' death warrants a response. We're not universalists. And I don't know about y'all, but it's not something that I want, a road that I want to go down. It's only for those who receive the grace of the gospel through faith. And so when I was younger, it's funny because my aunts are actually here today. I'm talking about them. Surprise, surprise. Somebody told you guys, huh? I got to clean up the story a little bit. I was going to make them. I'm just playing. But years ago, my family on my father's side owned a restaurant called La Cabana. And yeah, hyped up. Dude, the thing is, La Cabana, oh, the food was so good. And now I only get to experience it like around Christmas time because that's when they make it. You know, they'll make some of the beans and whatnot. It's like, oh, it's the best time of the year. Anyways, when I was younger, they owned this restaurant. The great thing about it, I remember my mom would take me, my brother would take me, my sister, my pops. The great thing about it is because we're a family, we rolled up, got free food. Anybody have a connection like that? Dang, I was blessed, man. Dang, but it was the greatest thing. And, you know, as a little kid, I walked in, I felt like, is my booth ready, you know? I'm just playing. I wasn't like that, but it was cool. It was awesome, and I got free food. I loved the food. I was one of those kids when I was younger. You go to Mexican restaurants, like, I want a cheeseburger, you know? So, oh, my gosh. But I grew up, all right? I grew up. But my dad didn't work there or anything. He did when he was younger, but my aunts ran the restaurant after my grandparents passed away. And so within all of this, we got that free food, right? And we didn't have to work for it. My pops didn't work for it. My brother, I think, busboyed for a little bit, but we didn't have to, like, prepare the ingredients. They didn't say, like, hey, now that you ate, you got to go wash the dishes or anything like that, right? It was just, hey, because you're family, because we love you, because you're family, here is free food. So I want us to keep this in mind, because the gospel warrants a response, and that response leads to what we would call us becoming children of God, us becoming family to God, us becoming a part of his sons and daughters, and receiving the free gift of grace that we don't have to work for. We don't have to wash the dishes in the back, right? So I want to go back to Romans 3:23, because we're starting with bad news, but here's the good news. In verse Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and all fall short of the glory of God. There's the bad news. Here's the good news. And are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward, again, there's that word, as propitiation by his blood. And here's the response, because it doesn't stop there. It's not, thanks, Jesus, for doing that. I'm not going to acknowledge you. I'm not going to care about you. But it says, to be received by faith. to be received. And here's what I'm going to stop right there. I'm going to go into the Gospel of John in chapter 1, 11 through 13. Here's what it says about those who receive that gift of grace by faith. Here's what it is. It says, he came to his own. John 1, 11 through 13. It says, he came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. Him being Jesus says, but to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. That's the thing. Who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. When you receive Christ Jesus as the propitiation, the one who took our sins, the one who turned away God's wrath, the one who dealt with what we deserved, we then receive that gospel and we become children of God. And we don't have to work for anything. We don't have to try to be good enough to eventually reach heaven. We don't have to do so many works and then we do 105 and then that's the ticket right there. No, but rather we receive the free gift of grace through Christ Jesus, with which we then put our faith in him, and by that right, we now become children, people of God. We are his family, not of flesh, not of my will, but of the Spirit. But of the Spirit. In other words, he puts away the flesh and he says, no, you are my spiritual son. You are my spiritual daughter. You are my family. It's like we're going to mess up. We're going to go through hard times. We're going to sin. It's just our nature. But the gospel of Jesus Christ took on all of that. So that way we did not have to. He gave the right to become children of God. I don't give the right. You don't give the right. Nobody outside of like anywhere can say, well, I'm giving myself the right. He gave the right to become children of God, but not to do nothing with, but to be received by faith. By faith. So that's the thing. In Jesus' death, this is like a paradox. In Jesus' death, mercy was given at the highest order. For who? It's not a trick question. Us. I know sometimes it's like, oh, I don't want to say the wrong thing. Through Jesus' death, mercy was given to whom? And through Jesus' death, wrath was carried out on whom? On Jesus. It's a paradox. Simultaneously, through Jesus' death, wrath was carried out and mercy. So guess what? The character of God, mercy wasn't given. He didn't look away. He didn't say, I'll just pretend like it never happened. No, he carried out justice. He carried out his wrath. But he also put forward mercy. He also put forward forgiveness. He also put forward love. In that way, satisfying and completing the picture of God. In God, in the world of Christ, in God's order, created order here, justice must be carried out. But mercy was carried out at the same time. So we see the cross of Christ as both wrath carried out and mercy given. It's a beautiful thing. And so finally, this idea, right, because I talked about it, it's to be lived out daily. It's to be lived out daily, right? It's not just like, hey, it's a moment. Hey, that happened 2,000 years ago. Or, hey, I was saved like 20 years ago, but I don't really know what to do with it now. We need to become gospel-preaching people, and we're going to talk about that more next week. But there's a verse that I want to read in Ephesians 2. And if you have your Bible, I want you guys to turn to this one. It's Ephesians 2, verses 8 through 10. Ephesians 2, verses 8 through 10. And it says this, because I think sometimes we think, like, gospel is just for me, and that's it. I don't need to preach it. I don't need to teach it. I don't need to live it. It's just for me. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. And it ends there. But that's not even what Scripture says. And so let's see this idea of living it out. Let's see what this means. In Ephesians 2, 8 through 10, it says this. For by grace you have been saved through faith. Make sense to everybody? Right? Cool. And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God. Make sense? correct. I can't make myself righteous. I can't say like, oh, this is what's good. I'm justifying myself. It's the gift of God. Cool. Verse 9, not a result of works. Everybody tracking still. It's making perfect sense. So that no one may boast, because nobody can boast. Nobody can declare somebody else innocent. Here's verse 10. Here's the beautiful thing. And here's the one that's like, oh, shoot, you know? It says, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in him. In other words, even Jesus didn't prepare the gospel just so we could sit at home and do nothing with it. He prepared. It doesn't say that you could maybe walk in if you want. It doesn't say these works, these things that God has for you, that when you find time, it says that we should walk in them. Gospel acceptance in your life, in my life, in the life of anybody is but the beginning. It's but the beginning. Now, as a person of God, here's the beautiful thing. And this is part of the reason we see it all the way from the Israelites too. God does not save us. God does not bring us into the fold of his family just for us to sit there. No, he has a plan and he has a will. And he's always used his people as kind of the paradigm shift to show surrounding cultures, to show surrounding people who God, Yahweh, is. In other words, he wants to use us to partner in ministry with him through the gospel of Jesus Christ. But a holy God wants a holy people. And so in sending Jesus Christ, we are now made holy and we are now made righteous in the family of God. So now we can be a part of his ministry, be a part of what he is doing. Because the gospel, I'm sorry to say, this is not about me and it's not about you. It's about what God has for his people. And it says, we're created in Christ Jesus. This is awesome, for good works. And it's like, You know, I think oftentimes we hear the idea of works and good works and stuff, and it's like, well, that's like a Roman Catholic thing, you know? I don't gotta do stuff. And it's like, well, somebody explain this verse to me, please. Because the thing, we're not saved by works. We're not saved by how good we can be. We're not saved by tallying up all the good things we've done in life. But now that we are saved, we are his workmanship. Right? Am I my own workmanship? Am I my own new creation? Are you your own new creation? So because now I am his workmanship, I'm going to partner in the works that he has set before me. So guess what this means? And this is the part, it's like, oh, shoot, really? If I am Christ's, if I am God's workmanship, his creation, that means my finances, my wife, my life, my job, my car, the clothes that I wear, guess what they all represent? Guess whose they are? God's. Because I'm not my own anymore. I was bought with a price. I was bought with the blood of Jesus Christ to be a new creation in Christ, but not to sit on my butt. Not to just, well, I'm saved now, so I'm good. I'm just going to wait till I die so I could go to heaven. No, so I could walk in the good works that God has prepared beforehand for us to walk in. The gospel is a message of action. The gospel is like a belief in a living God who's moving, who's active. It's not belief in a God who just says, you're okay, I'm going to tie a bow on you and you're going to be good till you die. But I think, unfortunately, if that Barna study is anything to say, I think that's what a lot of us have made the gospel. Something that's for me. I'm saved. I'm good. I'm taken care of. So I'm just going to live my life. But we must remember that there are people who are hurting. There are people who are far off from God. Do you remember? Even when you're going through it, and you feel far off from God, isn't that the worst? But there are people who have no communion with him, who are in opposition of him. And we have to remember that. Because again, Who did God ordain to walk in the works? Who did God ordain to walk in the gospel preaching, right? We're in the book of Acts. Did Jesus just like talk with God and God was like, all right, Jesus, you go out to the ends of the earth and you just do everything for these people? Or was he like, oh, actually, the apostles, like, you guys are going to go do it? Because again, the gospel is not just a message to be received. It's not just a moment, but it's a movement to be lived out. And God has brought us into his family, not to just sit around and do nothing, but rather to be able to partner with him in his ministry. And that's what the gospel is. And in doing that, we do not live an eternity away from God. Because that's for those who don't put their faith in Christ, for those who do not receive by faith, they spend an eternity away from God in hell. I know nobody likes to hear that, but I would be willing to say this. I'm going to go on a little tangent for a second. I think there is an extreme lack of a fear of the Lord in our culture. I think there's just a God is who I make him out to be. God will just agree with everything I got to say. I get really spiritual during worship and during I listen to my music. I never read the Bible, but man, God is just speaking to me so much. What? We need to get back to a place, man, because you take a look around. We're living in a postmodern, post-Christian era of our culture, right? The church needs to step up. The church needs to get back to it's like, oh no, I carry the gospel message. I know what it is. I know how to speak it. I know how to break it down. And I'm going to confidently walk in this. But the thing is, again, if we don't know what we're talking about, are we willing to talk about it? Probably not. That's why we're getting back to the basics. This isn't just to be like, we're going to have a super Christian message today and everybody will get this and understand it. No, this is to equip the believers, to equip each and every one of us. Because as a church, we're a new church, right? If we are not gospel-centered, if we're not gospel-preaching believers, this will be fun for about a year or two more, but then it's like, all right, we're done. Let's close up shop. That's just the truth. Because again, if we're not gospel-living people, preaching, teaching, understanding, reading the word, then we're just putting on a show. And it's about me, it's about Dylan, it's about setup crew, it's about singing some songs that kind of make me feel good. I want us to go underneath the surface, man. And you guys probably can tell from the way I preach or from the way I talk or teach. And I don't say any of this. I'm just speaking from my heart right now, honestly, so I apologize. But I don't mean to ever sound like the guy, you guys are all bad, you know? That's not it at all. I just have like a fire burning within me to equip Christians with the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ and to equip Christians with the truth and power of the word. And in doing so, we now become Christians who walk in what God has for us in the works. And we see our families come to know Christ and we see our friends come to know Jesus and the broken relationships, the family member you haven't talked to in 20 years and 15 years that is reconciled and the son or daughter that you have that's far off that you think, man, they're just never going to Jesus, I don't know what's going to happen. No. We're going to see in our lifetime, Jesus, you do something miraculous. But we need to be a church that's active, that's breathing, and that is gospel living. Not gospel was a moment when I got saved, but gospel is my life. The gospel is everything I live, I breathe, and I die on. That's it. And the gospel seeps out of every part of my body, everything that I do is to point back to the gospel of Jesus Christ, that he saved me, he redeemed me, he loves me, he cares about me, he saved me from an eternity away from him, he took me away from my sin that I still want so bad, but he pulled me from that I could walk in his grace, walk in his mercy, walk in his power, walk in his authority. But now I don't want to just walk in it alone. I want us to do it together. And I want us to impart that truth onto the people around us. Because you need to remember, you have the most powerful message in the entire universe. In the entire universe, the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. lack of the fear of the Lord that I talked about in the beginning, I just think like, man, we don't really talk about sin anymore. So it's like when the church stops talking about sin, the outside world, you think they're talking about it? If the church stops talking about sin, the church for generations has like brought culture back every time. Brought him back. Because we are the people of God. That's just the truth. If we don't do it, nobody else is going to do it. It's like you got some dishes in your sink, like, so hopefully somebody washes them, you know? If you don't do it, and man, the church needs a kick in the butt in our culture. I can't speak for around the world. I don't know what's going on around the world. But the thing is, I know God's sovereign. I know he's powerful. But I do know that God, eventually, it's like, man, he asked his Israelite people so many times, turn back to me. And finally, he's like, all right, I'm going to let you guys have your way then. And I want us to be a church that's like, Lord, I turn back to you, Father. I turn back to you. Because I would be like, I'm not saying everybody's walking these terrible sins, but we all sin. Yes, absolutely. But is the gospel like your lifeblood? Is the gospel what wakes you up in the morning? Is the truth of Jesus Christ what gets you out of bed and what comes out of your mouth in every moment that you can? Every moment that you can speak about it, any moment that you can share it. Is it something like that, or is it something that's packed away? And so in that sense, we need to turn back to the Lord and turn back to the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, give us confidence. Holy Spirit, give us boldness. Holy Spirit, like, empower me to be able to reach the people that you would have me reach. Because remember, they're not denying you, they're denying Christ. Walk in that power. Walk in that authority. And I probably sound like a broken record over and over and over and over, but I need to beat it into our heads. I'm just being up. 50% of Christians share the gospel maybe once a year. I placed a mirror in front of me when I read that. I was like, oh my gosh, I need to step it up. Just truthfully, because again, it's not like, yeah, I'm up here and I do it all the time and you guys don't. It's like, oh man, we got some work to do, amen? But it's through the power of Christ. It's through the empowering of the Holy Spirit. Seek the Lord. Don't let your method of coming to Christ only be like worship music or prayer. Read his word. That's who he tells us who he is, how he operates, how he works, you know? That's what's happening. It's like, I'll go on and on and on. I'm just going to stop, actually. I'll go on and on and on. But let's be Christians who walk empowered. And the thing is, like, the people here, we can do this together. Together. It's scary doing things by myself, right? When you're going to hop out and you're just going to do it. It's like, but man, when you have your family behind you, when you have your brothers and sisters behind you, it's like, oh, like you shared the gospel to one of your coworkers? Shoot, okay, like, dang, I need to step up. And we do this together as a family. So now here's the thing. And if there's more questions, let's talk about them after. But we all understand the gospel. We know what sin is. We know what Christ's death on the cross was, wrath and mercy. We know that we are now part of the family of God. We know that all fall sin and fall short of the glory of God. We know that if we don't put our faith in Jesus Christ, then we spend an eternity away from God, right? So now that we know, therefore go. Simple as that. But let's do that. Let's be empowered. I love you guys so much. And again, I don't want you guys to think I'm like, this is for everybody, myself included. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for this time that we have had together, Jesus. I thank you that we could just come together and as a family talk about the hard things, Lord. I'm grateful that we have a church that wants to hear and understand and know your gospel. I'm grateful that we have a place just to worship you, Jesus. I'm grateful that we live a life that we're not persecuted. We don't have anything like that against us, Lord. We can just come and worship you freely, God. I'm grateful for that, Lord. And Lord, I would ask right now that you would just light a fire in each and every one of us, God. I pray that right now. You know what? If you're in the audience and you're like, man, I need that fire within me, I want you to just stand up right now. wherever you're at, just stand up and let's pray together. You don't have to come to the altar. You don't have to, but we're just going to stand up and pray together. It's like, man, I need that fire. I need that like authority. I need God to just like kick me in the butt right now. Because I'm going to be honest, I don't know about y'all, but scripture describes like human activity apart, like human activity in general is like, man, not the greatest. We need the Lord in every single aspect of our life. And that does not come overnight. Like, okay, we had a good time right now. It's like, no, Lord, I need your power. I need your authority. So let's lift our hands to heaven. Let's lift our hands to God. And let's ask him together.